I want to say good evening and welcome to all of those on the live stream on this evening. And we are just grateful for the invitation to come and be with the Vaughn Park Church on tonight. And I pray that the words and that God have given me to share with you are both beneficial and uplifting. And I trust that we will gain much from the Word of God and what God has been doing and is doing in all of our lives. We would be encouraged tonight. We are living in some very uncertain, difficult, dangerous, unbelievable, incredible times. COVID-19, coronavirus, has come, and we have never seen anything like this in our life. We don't know what to do, but I know tonight someone who can handle anything. His name is Jesus. Amen. I am glad to be asked to come and share on this great theme for the summer, the seven signs of Jesus from the book of John. John happens to be my favorite, if I could say such, of the four synoptic gospels. I love John. And I love the story behind John. John writes about Jesus in a more intimate way, if you will, than the other writers. John considers himself a personal friend of Jesus. John called himself that disciple whom the Lord loves. I think I would have said that as well. But what I love about John, Matthew writes to the Jews, and Matthew presents Jesus as King of the earth. Mark's writing is addressed to the Romans, and what Mark talks a lot about Jesus' power, because the Roman people, they were the world ruling dominant power of New Testament time. Luke writes to the Grecian mind, and so Luke, the doctor, he talks about discipleship. He talks about studying, learning, and being a disciple of Jesus. But then John writes from a universal perspective for all believers to see that Jesus is the Savior of the whole world. Y'all, during these dangerous times, during these heartbreaking times, during these hurtful, painful times, coronavirus, COVID-19, and then to add pain on top of pain, misery on top of misery, the racial unrest, the racial bias, police brutality that's found in our society. It is one of those things where we don't want to talk much about it because we don't want to offend anyone. We don't want to really address the idea that there's really racial issues in America. There's even racial issues in our churches. But I believe that Jesus is the answer to everything. And as we look at these seven signs this summer, brethren, I want you to think about the fact, and here in John 2, turning water into wine, we'll get into it, but what I want you to really think about is God the Father. Remember that occasion, John 14:19, when Philip said, "Father, Jesus, show us the Father, that it might suffice us." And Jesus says, "When you've seen me, you've seen the Father." John 1:14, Jesus, he became flesh. The Word became flesh and dwelt amongst us. And so what Jesus was trying to say is everything God is, I am. Every solution to every problem, I am the answer to what the world needs today, what it needed in first century time. And when we look at John chapter 2 particularly, we're going to talk about the power of God on display. Jesus performs his first miracle in Cana of Galilee. I love the gospel according to John. In John 12:32, Jesus over there, Jesus said, "If I be lifted up from the earth, I will draw all men unto myself." What I want to suggest tonight, brethren, is that we are the ones that need to lift up the mighty name of Jesus. What the world needs most is those of us that truly, really know the Lord. They need us to tell them the way you change problems, the way you fix problems, you share love, you share love, you share Jesus, you share friendship, you share relationship. And we as the people of God need to show the world. Listen, you can't pass laws and you can't legislate love. If America's going to change, let me tell you something. No, we're not going to have a political debate. Make America great again. You better get in the Word of God if you want that to happen. Amen, walls and light. You can't DC President Trump, Governor Ivey, nor any other political person can change the heart of man. The problem to racism, any other thing in the world, police brutality, whatever it might be, is for hearts to change. Laws can change on paper each and every day, but if our hearts are not changing, but what a horrible place, what a horrible world we're living in right now. Coronavirus, COVID-19, Montgomery as a city, nearly 3,000 cases that we know of right here in our city. The leading city in the state of Alabama. So, brethren, we have a lot to be prayerful about. We have a lot to be concerned about. We have a lot to ask God for help about. We have a lot of service that we need to do. There's a lot of work need to be done. There are a lot of people we need to talk to. A lot of people we need to reach out to check on. Because, as already prayed, we are the hands, the feet, we're the shoulders of Jesus. And as a matter of fact, we're Jesus' voice, and we're the ones that's going to tell the world and show the world the way of the cross leads home. When I look at John's gospel, yes, we need to lift up Jesus. John did that in an outstanding, marvelous way. He tells us who Jesus is. In John 1, verse 29 and 36, he says when he sees Jesus coming, John said, "Behold, the Lamb of God that takes away the sins of the world." Here in John 2, be back to it in a moment. But what John does, John gives us Jesus' first miracle, and John presents Jesus as a great miracle worker. John 3, 16, he shows us Jesus who's the Savior of the world. John chapter 4, Jesus is presented as being the light of the world, and even a six-time divorce, seven-time shacking Samaritan woman can find hope by meeting Jesus. John 5, he's the honored judge. John 6, he's the bread of life. John 7, he's a righteous judge. John 8, he's the light of the world. John 9, he's the compassionate Son of God. That a man born blind can receive a sight. John 10, he's a good shepherd. He knows his sheep. Verse 14 of John 10, and his sheep knows him. John 11, he's a compassionate Son of God who never forgets a friend. 4 days Lazarus is laying in the grave. Mary and Martha, they're worried, they're crying, they're coming about. But Jesus says, "I'm going because my friend Lazarus is asleep." Thank God for Jesus. John 12, he's the one who has saving words. 48, the Bible says of John 12, "He that rejecteth me and receiveth not my words hath one to judge him. In the last day, the words I've spoken, the same shall judge him in the last day." John 13, he's the humble servant who's willing to get on his knees and wash our dirty feet. And Jesus tells his disciples, "What you've seen me do, go and do likewise." John 14, Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. John 15, he's the true vine. John 16, he's the comfort giver. John 17, hear the real Lord's prayer. He's the praying Son of God. Oh, I love this prayer. The world needs this prayer tonight. John 17, 20, Jesus prayed, "Neither pray I for these alone, but for all of them that shall believe on me through the words in which they preach." Watch this, church. that they all may be one. Yeah. That was Christ's prayer. That we all might be one, talking to God the Father. As thou, Father, art in me, as I am in thee. Watch this. That the world may believe that thou hast sent me. My heart breaks when I see the racial tension in our country. My heart breaks because I realize that's not the way of Christ. That's not the way of the church of Christ. That's not the way we should behave ourselves. But Jesus is the answer. John 17, when Jesus prayed that prayer, he said the condition for the church and for Christians showing the world who I am is by the unity that we share one with another. Brethren, I'm calling us tonight, let's stop seeing skin color and let's start seeing souls. Let's stop seeing skin and let's start seeing the salvation of Jesus. And if you don't see and recognize the salvation of Jesus and who you're talking to, then let's do our job and try to bring the word of Christ, the gospel to people that they might have what we have. Jesus prayed in just this prayer that we might be one, that the oneness in the church down here might look like the oneness in heaven above. And you answer that question. Does our congregations on earth resemble what they're going to look like in heaven? Back in John 13, Jesus over there, I'm talking about what's going to make the world believe that God has sent him. The second thing, he talked about our unity in John 17. John 13, he talked about our love. John 13, 34, a new commandment I give unto you, that you love one another as I've also loved you. Jesus says, and by this shall all men know that you are my disciples. Where I preach, we just got a beautiful sign just made. Northside Church of Christ. Beautiful sign in Crimson Tide red. Say amen. Knock on wood. This is glass. Okay. All right. Beautiful red sign. But can I tell you tonight, it is not the sign that makes us God's children. It is not the sign that says to unbelievers that we are truly the children of God. It's the love and the unity that we share that helps the whole world to see that we're truly God's children. John 18, he's a betrayed son of God. John 19, he's our crucified Savior. Who is this Jesus? As we think about and talk about these seven signs, I know we're on the first one tonight, but as we think about these signs, think about the fact that Jesus paid a debt he did not owe. I owe a debt I could not pay. In John 19, when Jesus hung on that cross, he prayed, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Woman, behold your son. Behold your mother. He cried, I thirst. He cried, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? Then he said, Father, into your hands I commend my spirit. You know, I want to suggest to you tonight, the way we change America is we preach Jesus. John 20, he's a risen Lord. And John 21, he's the one we ought to follow. Maybe came to Simon Peter and said, Simon, let us not be more than these. Three times, Peter said, Lord, yes, you know I love you. Third time, Jesus says, go and feed my sheep. Vaughn Park, do you love Jesus more than your own life, more than things, situation, people? Go and feed my sheep. When I go to John chapter 2 tonight, the third day the Bible said that verse 1, while the marriage in Cana of Galilee and the mother of Jesus was there, both Jesus was called and his disciples to the marriage. When they wanted wine, the mother of Jesus said unto him, they have no wine. Verse 4, Jesus said unto her, woman, what have I to do with thee? My time is not yet come. His mother said unto the servants, whatsoever he saith, do it. His mother, verse 6, there were set before him 6 water pots of stone, at the manner of purifying of the Jews, containing 2 or 3 firkins apiece. 6 water pots, the water pots holding each of them 20 to 30 gallons. Do the math. 120, 180 gallons of wine Jesus made. You remember the story? Came to the bridegroom, or rather to the groom, and said, you've had good wine, but you've saved the best for last. What I want to share with us tonight is that Jesus does and provides the absolute best of everything that we need. Hear what he says to his mother, woman, what have I to do with thee? In our day and time, in our English culture, it seemed as if he's been very disrespectful. I have 3 daughters and I love them dearly, but they better not walk in the kitchen and tell my wife, woman, cook me some food. Maybe we wouldn't do that in this culture, would we? But actually the term woman in New Testament time was a term of respect, reverence, and endearment. It was a term signifying that he realized he was talking to someone he honored, someone he cherished, and someone he loved. The 6 water pots was a great amount of wine. And what good Church of Christers do, what good traditionalists do, we've debated for years and years and years, why would Jesus make that much fermented wine, get people drunk, and then condemn us for drunkenness? Excuse me, you missed the point. The point of this text is to reveal to all that Christ has power to do anything. His miracles, signs and wonders began right here in John 2. This particular miracle, he was at a social gathering, and here at the social gathering, there were folk from every place. New Testament time, a wedding feast was the greatest social gathering of all times. A wedding feast was a very intimate time where everybody came. Isn't it interesting that his very first miracle was at this great gathering? And the story is told that the absolute best wine was the wine that Jesus made here at the inn. Then what I want you to see about this gathering, not only was it where Jesus performed this first miracle, this gathering and this miracle was unquestionable. They couldn't doubt it. They knew something awesome had just happened. John 20, 30 and 31, the Bible says, many other signs, true in it, Jesus, in the midst of his disciples, watch this, but these are written, the seven signs you'll talk about for the rest of the summer. From John's gospel, these are written that you might believe, and that believing you might have life through his name. Somebody that day in that audience, in that assembly, at that gathering, left knowing and believing that Jesus indeed is the Son of God. His mother saying to the servant, whatever he saith, do it. Inspiration doesn't give us all the details. Inspiration doesn't talk about at what point, at what time he changed water to wine. I don't know if it's from the time the water was poured in or the water was poured out. Don't know at what point. But what I know is that God chose us with the power to change and the power to fix any situation is found in the Lord Jesus Christ. And then John 21, 25, John says, I suppose that if all that Jesus had done had been recorded in books, John says all the world's books could not contain all that he had done. So brethren, tonight as we go forward this summer, as you go talking about these seven sayings, understand these are intricate details about the life of Jesus that God placed within the canon of Scripture, within John's writings, to help us believe and know that truly Jesus Christ is indeed God's Son. And what I suggest to you tonight, in the midst of all the horrible things that's going on, tell your neighbor, tell your friends, tell the world, show them we have the answer. No, we don't know what the answer is, and a part of our true confession is tonight is that humanly we don't know, but spiritually we know who is in control, and that is Jesus. When I look at all that we're dealing with today, my heart breaks because what God prayed for, not just equality, not just salvation, not just his people being one, but Jesus prayed that we all might have his mind and that we all might have the mindset of unity and togetherness as heaven does within itself. Brethren, I want to leave you tonight with three nuggets. Three things I believe that the church could glean from this passage of John 2 that will help us help the body. This time of racial unrest, police brutality, coronavirus, illness, sickness, people are hurting. Hearts are broken. Minds are fixated on things they ought not be fixated on. People need someone and something to hold on to. And I want to give you three things I believe I learned from this text, or I gleaned from the purpose in the mind of Christ that will help us today to be able to help somebody. First thing I want you to realize is the power is still in the hands of God, in Jesus' hand, to help, to fix America, to fix our community, to help all of us get along like we ought to get along. The power is in God's hand. The Bible tells us, Matthew 19, 26, with men, these things are impossible, but with God, all things are possible. What did Paul say? Philippians 4:13, I can do all things through Christ, which strengtheneth me. Brethren, I believe tonight that's our story. We got to stick to it. I believe that's what we must tell them. We must preach and let the world know that we can do these things through Christ. The power to change, the power to solve the issue, the power to fix America, the problem, the power to fix a police department. God can do it. God can change hearts. And I want you to understand tonight that no, I don't stand here before you as a black man only. I don't stand here as a black man first. I stand before you as your Christian brother, as a child of God. I stand as one who has experienced the changing power of Jesus in my life. Amen. And as you sit there tonight, you know what? You know, I see skin color, but I'm not hung up. I'm not bothered. I'm not minimized. I'm not worried. I'm not defeated. I don't judge based upon one's exterior. You know why? Because the power of Jesus has done his job on me. And I love all of God's people. I don't dislike police officers. As a matter of fact, some of my best friends in the world are white police officers. No, I don't want to defund the police. Man, we need the police. I would probably run the red light if it wasn't for the police. I would probably, amen, God forgive. But yeah, if there weren't no laws, no police officers, we all would break laws, wouldn't we? Okay, pinch yourself, but tell the truth. We need the police. We're not against police officers. Brethren, and I'll say it once and I'll say it again. It's not just laws. It's not legislation. It's going to make us great again. It is hearts being changed by the power of God and the power of God's people. Hear me. Speaking out to help solve the issues. Silence is not good. God's point and God's position need to be broadcast and told. Ephesians 3:20, the Apostle Paul over there talking about God now and him that is able to do exceedingly, abundantly above all that we ask or think. But the power that worketh in us, what are you saying, Paul? Jesus has the power to change lives, to fix the world. The second thing I want to leave you with tonight, not just the power is in God's hand. I reiterate, people's hearts must turn to Jesus in order for the world to really get a good picture, a good image of what heaven looks like. Hearts must turn to Jesus. Hearts must be like him. Philippians 2 verse 5, the Apostle Paul says, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. Proverbs 23 verse 7, as a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. And my third and final point tonight, that doesn't come directly from this John 2 text, but I want to make this point and I want to stand on this. I believe the Bible backs it. If it wasn't true by God, I wouldn't say it. But I want all of us to understand tonight that if we're going to be the people of God, we all must agree that prejudiceness from any people under any circumstance in any situation is sin. I said it once and I'll say it again. Prejudiceness from any people under any condition or circumstance is sin. James chapter 2. James says, verse 1, have not the faith of the Lord Jesus Christ, the Lord of glory, with respect to persons. James says, for there come into your assembly a man wearing a gold ring, dressed in goodly apparel. And you say to him, sit thou over here in a good place. And there come also in a poor man dressed in vile raiment. And you say to him, sit thou there under my footstool. Are you not then judges of evil thoughts? Hearken, my beloved brethren. Hath not God chosen upon this world rich in faith and heirs of the kingdom? Just given to those that love him. But then James says, verse 6, but you have despised the poor. Do not rich man oppress you and drag you before the judgment seat. Verse 8, here's the answer. If you fulfill the royal law according to the scripture, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. But if you have respect to persons, you commit sin. And you are convinced of the law as a transgressor. May God help us tonight to take the world to John 2 and show them the power of Jesus, the power of God, to change whatever condition, position, circumstance we're going through. Take them to John 2 and show them that people's heart must change. Not just changing laws, not just changing legislation. Hearts must change. Then you, as a child of God, you got to tell them, Jesus prayed that we might be one. I don't care if you're black, white, red, blue, or brown. If you have prejudiceness in your heart, you're going the opposite way of Jesus. And that's sin. Remember this verse? Galatians 3:26-28. For you are all the children of God by faith in Christ Jesus. Watch this. For as many of you as have been baptized into Christ have put on Christ. Listen, where there is neither Jew nor Greek, bond nor free, male nor female, for we're all one in Christ Jesus. You can't get 2, 3, 4, or 5 from one. I don't care how you slice it. One is still one. And I'm glad tonight that my brethren at the Vaughn Park Church of Christ, we're family. The brethren at the Northside Church of Christ, and there ain't nothing you can do about that. But love me as I love you. And allow the power of God to change me as it changed me to change you. And then begin to live your life every day, realizing God could change the world. I don't see skin color. I see souls that know Jesus or need to get to know Jesus. And I have the answer. If you're here tonight, make these changes. Allow this text to touch your life. Let's close in prayer. Father, God, I thank you for the conviction this text brings to my heart. God, I see your power. And I see who you are. And God, I see that you sent Jesus to reveal to us your true nature, your true heart. God, I pray for all of us in this assembly as we're living in these perilous times. Pray, God, you'll fix our minds, fix our hearts. Help us, dear Lord, to be a part of the solution, to speak out against wrong wherever it might be. Thank you, God, for this church that's feeding hungry folk and doing good in the community, even at this time when there are great needs. I pray, God, you bless the shepherds in this congregation. Give them good wisdom, good vision, God, to minister and lead. Bless the preacher search. Bless the ministers that are still here working. But God, bless the Vaughn Park Church to keep doing good, to bring glory and honor to your name. Bless us at Northside. Order our steps, Lord. Direct us, protect us, guide us, and keep us. We love you, Lord. We pray this prayer in Jesus' name. Amen and amen.